Good morning, everyone. My name is Tomohiro Suzuki from Flanders Hydraulics Research. The title of this presentation is An Efficient Coupling Method for Wave Generation of Maximum Wave in Mild and Shallow Foreshore. My co-authors are Corrado Altomare from UPC and Orlando Garcia Fell from Vigo University. First of all, this work is an application of dual physics to coastal engineering. In the picture, you can see a mild and shallow foreshore, which means a beach in an easy word. For us coastal engineers, one of the most important issues is the people's safety during an extreme storm. We coastal engineers know overtopping events well, but we do not know so much about the post-overtopping processes. For example, we do not know what can be happened inside the apartment building when a big wave hits on the building. Therefore, my intention of this work is to understand such post-overtopping events further by means of dual physics. In order to know the post-overtopping events, we need to simulate wave propagation properly. To do that, we need to run the model from offshore. However, we need a very long simulation. Dual physics is a detailed model, and thus it is rather difficult to apply it for such study by standalone. To avoid such long simulation, coupling with a light wave model will be useful. This video shows a coupling of dual physics and SWASH. SWASH is a wave model which based on a shallow water equation, and thus the computation is very fast. However, coupling cannot be applied everywhere. For example, the conventional coupling method using moving boundary cannot be applied at a very shallow zone. In our case, such coupling is not the best option. Yet, an efficient simulation method is necessary to study the post-overtopping events in details. Therefore, we try to explore an efficient wave generation method in this study. After some discussion, we found a kind of compromise that is so-called a calibration method. Here, calibration means optimization of wave paddle movement at the shallow zone. Using this approach, wave generation can be very efficient in terms of time and space. Time is short because we can only generate the target wave. Space is also small since we start simulation close to the dike. On top, the calibration can be done in 2D instead of 3D. The calibration can be achieved together with the light wave model and the visualization software. In our case, we used open source code, SWASH and FaraView. On one hand, SWASH creates the target incident wave signal on the dike, while on the other hand, the visualization software can assist the calibration. I can show you a concrete example later. For this method, SWASH needs to be able to reproduce realistic wave transformation and wave overtopping over dike. For my application, it has been already validated in literature. And thus, we assume the output of SWASH on the dike is accurate enough. Now, I will explain the calibration methodology step by step. First, SWASH needs to be simulated with 1,000 waves without apartment building in 2D. Then we take the maximum wave on the dike. Second, We need to calibrate the paddle movement of dual physics in order to reproduce the incident wave flow depth and velocity on the dike. If flow depth and velocity do not match to swash output, then correct the paddle movement in dual physics based on the result and the paraview visualization if necessary. This is an example how the calibration method works. The figure shows the output of swash. The yellow marked time window indicates the target wave, namely maximum wave. This figure shows the time series of flow depths and the flow velocity of the maximum wave. As the first step, velocity obtained from swash is used for the paddle movement close to the toe. However, it was not successful. Possible reason is that the water mass was too limited, as can be seen in the figure. Note that this is one of the reasons that the conventional coupling method do not work in such case. And this resulted in no overtopping. On the second try, we made the toe deeper and the place of the paddle more offshore in order to have enough water mass in the domain. With a certain paddle movement we assigned, we observed a small overtopping. On the third try, we made a paddle movement faster. This made H too big. On the fourth try, we used informational paraview. On the top right panel, you can see the result. As you can see, there are two peaks of the flow depths. This needs to be smaller. If we can see the paraview visualization, we can see the timing of the wave generation of these two peaks. We made the paddle velocity smaller in such moments. This is an example. So as you can see, the first wave passing to the crest and the second wave is passing now at the crest. So the second wave actually go back in time. Then we can see that the second wave was generated at the moment of 17 seconds. And the first wave was generated at the moment of 12 seconds. This information was reflected into the calibration, let's say paddle speed. We repeated such kind of small correction and finally we got an acceptable result. This iteration is not very time consuming since one run is only 20 minutes in my case. When we look at the details of this figure, we can realize that the tail of the flow depth had some fluctuation. This is actually due to the fact that we used modified dynamic boundary condition in this study. When the layer becomes very thin, the particle becomes unstable. Finally, using the calibration paddle movement, a simulation is conducted to visualize the wave behavior inside the room in an apartment with furniture in 3D. So this is a video we created. So as you can see, waves are propagating in front of the dike. And eventually it overtops and it hits to the furniture and hits to the wall behind. And the waves are going back to the sea. Okay, So the conclusions of this work. There's three points. First, any single wave can be reproduced by means of calibration method. The good thing is that this method is also applicable to the force estimation on the wall, which is a common practice in course engineering. Second, the calibration method saves a lot of time of simulation. Because this method makes the simulation only one wave instead of 1,000 waves. And the domain size is also very small, 50 meter in our case instead of 1,000 meter. And we can do this calibration in 2D instead of 3D. The third point is that the 3D wave behavior inside the room with furniture is visualized via Blender. There's a big benefit that the dual physics is possible to make further risk analysis possible. So for example, the risk of debris in our case is furniture moving. And if people inside the room, it can be a big risk for the people. So we can also discuss about the risk by such kind of visualization. So this is the end of the presentation. Thank you very much.